it will be incomplete fight if we don't learn from the pandemic. So, for example, while I was busy in the pandemic, it gave me some time to sit down and reflect that what I want to do. So we should utilize this opportunity, this challenge as an opportunity to spend time with your family, with your loved one, learn some new skills, and also spread positivity. The pandemic will be over, so nobody should be scared.
Greetings, ladies and gentlemen. Today, it is an honor and a pleasure for me to introduce you all to this very particular session where we are going to know more about the COVID-19 lessons. My name is Harsh and I'm going to moderate this session for all of you, wherein I'm going to introduce you all about the event and perhaps the person who is going to interact and address all of us. First of all, I request you to kindly acknowledge and welcome the presence of our esteemed guest, and he is very dynamic, very interesting and very charming personality, none other than Dr. Chandrakant Laharia, who is here with us. I would like to request all the person, those who are watching this session on YouTube, to kindly applaud in the comment section and welcome the presence of our guest. Dr. Chandrakant Laharia is a medical doctor, leading policy health system expert and lead author of Till We Win, India Fights the COVID-19 Pandemic, published in December 2020. Dr. Laharia has received advanced training in epidemiology, vaccinology, immunology and public health. In 2012, he received the Indian Council of Medical Research Dr. B.C. Srivastava Foundation Award for his work and on translating community-based health research into public policy interventions. He is the youngest fellow ever elected to Indian Public Health Association. And I believe his profile has so many things, so many glories, which I won't be able to explain in the next few minutes. But I'm pretty sure during this conversation, we are going to learn a lot from him. So first of all, sir, I welcome you to in this session. Thank you so much for joining and agreeing to share your thoughts with us.
Thank you very much, Harsh. It's my pleasure. Come to the audience and participant.
Thank you so much, sir. It's our pleasure too. So, sir, moving to the topic of today's session, which we have chosen is COVID-19, lesson learned and future directions. Sir, my first question to you is, we all know very well recently your book was published, Till We Win, India Fights Against COVID-19 Pandemic. So, sir, my first question to you is, how did you come up with this very interesting topic? It is, when I have seen this first time, it looked like very interesting and I'm very curious to know about it.
So, our book is titled Till We Win, which is a positive message. We wanted to write a book about hope and positivity. So, we know that the COVID-19 pandemic period has been challenging for everyone. We have faced many hardships and hurdles, and this is true for everyone, starting from the migrant worker to the office goer and children, housewife, and people seeking healthcare. So this has been a challenging period, and sort of none of us had ever seen in our lifetime. We keep hearing about pandemics, 1918-19, Spanish flu pandemic, but probably, and there would be anyone who is alive from the previous pandemic. So this has been a hardship period. What is sure that at the end of it, we will win against this pandemic. So we wanted to give a message and positive message that while we have faced hardship, but together we will win. And that's what the message in this book is. At the same time, we wanted to give people some of the technical information which they wanted to know. For example, people were being told that they should wear face masks, wash hands, and then maintain physical distancing. This is fine, but we wanted to also tell them that why they need to do that. So that will increase adherence. So it's some book of hope, book of positivity.
All right, so it was really a very wonderful message from your side. And I think we all need to understand this. And I can say that if 2022 was all about the survival, then 2021 will all about the consciously shaping the future of health, the future of education, the future of warfare, the future of food, everything about the future we can look into 2021, and hopefully this pandemic will be over into this year. Sir, my next question to you is, what has helped or hindered you most when you were writing this book?
So in writing the book, there were two challenges. Like all three of us are involved in the pandemic response in various capacity. So writing a book was not a priority, definitely. We wanted to work to respond to the pandemic in our role. Dr. Guleria is the director of AIIMS and then involved in various activity at the various level. Dr. Kang and myself have our different roles which we were involved. So the most difficult part was finding the time to write the book, because book writing itself required a lot of effort. And the second challenge which we faced was that all three of us work at different places and are really busy, so coordinating time for each other. But then we realized that sometimes in the life you come across with those points where doing something becomes mandatory. You have to find the time. Like we had no choice, but we wanted to write this book to empower people, but also to learn some lessons from this pandemic. So we told ourselves, all three of us said that, okay, this book had to be written. So what we did, that we tried to steal time from our busy schedule, utilize our personal and family time and weekends, Saturdays and Sundays. So much of this book is written on those late evenings and late nights, and then extra coordination. So there had been challenges of coordinating, finding time. But at the end of it, we were very motivated, and we believe that this is the kind of book people need, and that's why we had to find time.
Very inspiring, sir. Sir, my next question to you is, what are your opinion? What are the good outcomes of this coronavirus pandemic?
So I will break this part, this question into two parts. One is that what are the lessons which we have learned, and then what are the good outcomes? So if we talk about the lessons, I would say that there are seven P's which we have learned. P for political will. We learned that if there is a political will, a lot can be achieved. And of course, as we want to improve health sector in India, the political will, which is sustained over a period of time, will be key. So the first P is political will. Second P, in my opinion, is a partnership. This pandemic could be fought because various departments, health department, education department, sanitation, PWD, police department, education department, all of them came together and pooled in their resources. For contact tracing, we needed health workers, but we also needed education workers, teachers were involved, we needed police personnel. So the role of partnership was emphasized. So that's the second P. Third, and one of the most important P learning, is people's participation. What we realize that nothing succeed unless it is the participation of people. So for example, if contact tracing need to be done, then the people need to cooperate. If the testing need to succeed, then people need to be made aware they come to the testing center. Most importantly, the key tools in pandemic response are hand washing, social distancing, and face mask. And these are public health tools, but these will not succeed till people adopt them. So people's participation has been the key learning from this pandemic. We know in Dharavi, which is a success story, it is a participation of people which made it a success story. But then there are other aspects in this pandemic. Another learning is public health facilities and services. We know that much of the pandemic has been fought on the public health facilities, which were providing outreach services and people going to the facility. The other P is the primary healthcare. The smaller healthcare facilities were really useful in delivering services. We know from Thailand and Vietnam and many countries that wherever there is a stronger primary healthcare system, smaller facility, those countries have succeeded in tackling pandemic fairly well than European countries which have a large hospital. Other learning from this pandemic is that the preventive and promotive health services. Now, I want to elaborate on this one. Like, for example, the much of the Europe and United States or America has a hospitals, which are treatment services. But the treatment services are not useful. And we see that if you treat only sick people, then it's a never-ending battle. So countries which deliver preventive or promotive health message, the message which reaches to the people, succeeded well. And the Thailand, Vietnam, South Korea, and Asian countries are an example. And the final P, in my opinion, is the private sector participation. though the role of private sector in the pandemic response has been limited, but we know that the testing needed to scale up, ventilator services, ICU, in some of the services, private sector provided a lot of contribution. So I summarize the 7 P: political will, partnership, people's participation, then public health services, primary healthcare, preventive promotive services, and the private sector. So these are the 7 learnings from this. Let me come to the second part quickly, that what are the good outcomes of this pandemic? We have learned a number of things. For example, at the beginning of the pandemic, when there was lockdown, India allowed the teleconsultation services. Now this, in my opinion, is a game changer. This can reduce the crowding at the facility, but also can make health services accessible for many people. For example, when people go to facility, they have to wait in the queue, they have to sit in the corridor. It takes 3 to 4 hours, and no matter whether you are young, old, pregnant. Now, take example of elderly individual. If somebody is 67 year old, earlier he had to go to a facility, wait for some time. It could be minimum some half an hour, maximum 2-3 hours, but travel time other will be required. With teleconsultation, it's possible that the only 15 minutes at the comfort of home, you can access health services. So this is going to be a revolution if utilized well. The other learning in this pandemic, other good outcome is that we know that mental health care services are a challenge in India. And the mental health care services are a reality. We have been hearing about death by suicide, and also the depression and other challenges. And we know that there are not sufficient mental health care services. The pandemic has highlighted the need for mental health care services. Another key learning from this pandemic is the power and possibility of research and development. The vaccines have come at a really quick pace, like never ever in history. The vaccines could be developed in such a shorter period, but now we have so many vaccines. So possibility of research and development in improving health is another learning. I'll quickly summarize a few other learning, like linkage between health and economy has been recognized. We know that in the quarter one, when there was lockdown, the Indian economy shrunk by nearly 24%. This was the biggest quarterly year-on-year reduction in economy in the last 24 years. So it showed that if health is not good, people's health is affected, it affects economy. So improving investment on health can improve economy. We also learned the importance of frontline healthcare workers. So there are many learnings, and I can go on and on, but it will be better I stop here. There are more learnings given in our book.
It was really very insightful answer from your side, and I must say that there is a lot to learn from you, sir. And I could say that it's a kind of privilege today we got to hear all those things from you. And I think the 7 P's approach which you have told, it must be appreciated. And so my next question to you is, what do you suspect the world to look like after the chaos of this coronavirus is over?
So the world is going through a challenge. Now, the good part is that situation is slightly improved, and we have vaccines around, so we hope that things will be better. However, it will be a missed opportunity if we don't learn from the challenges we have faced. So I believe that there would be 2 phases in this recovery or return to normal from pandemic. One phase will be that right now we are in the pandemic. We hope that there would be some point of time when World Health Organization, the international bodies, will declare that pandemic is over. Even when pandemic would be over, the coronavirus disease causing virus, SARS-CoV-2, will still be around. So pandemic can be over, but virus will stay with us for long, really, really long time. We don't know how long, but virus is unlikely to disappear. And both phases, we have to act differently. We are living in pandemic, and once we come out of it, then we still need to follow some of the protocols or COVID appropriate behavior. But I would like to suggest one approach as we recover from this pandemic and COVID-19, that is reject, revive, and innovate. What do I mean with these things? That coronavirus pandemic or COVID-19 pandemic has given us an opportunity to pause and stop and reflect that what are we doing. So there are a few things which are we are doing as a society wrong, like we are harming environment, and we are which is affecting climate, and which is also bringing the rare viruses and diseases to the humanity. So we need to reject all the things which are harming the society, which are harmful to the society. And we can look at per individual level also, that we need to examine that what we are, should not be doing. We should adopt a healthy lifestyle. So reject a unhealthy lifestyle. So that's a reject part. Then second part is revive. Of course, we were doing a number of things before pandemic, which were right, and which we could not do during the pandemic period. So we need to revive all the right things which we are doing at the individual and society level. But other part is that innovate. In the COVID-19 pandemic, it will be over. We need to innovate and see that how best we are utilizing those. We can utilize some of the learning. For example, we have learned how to connect over Zoom or other calls and virtual platform. Of course, we want to go back to our real meetings, but we need to innovate that how best to utilize our time, how best some of those social media, some of those virtual platforms can be utilized to save time. We also need to revive and innovate that how to give more time to our family members, how to give back to the society, and how to share those ideas. So at every individual, family, and society level, I would advise or suggest that each one of us should follow approach of reject some things which are wrong and which we should not do, revive what we have not been doing or we were doing earlier, but revive them, and innovate. We need to learn from all of this.
All right, sir. Again, it was really a very wonderful message from your side. Reject, reject, revive, and innovate. Sir, my next question to you is, what are the some industries that has completely been destroyed because of this COVID-19 pandemic?
So, Harsh, I would say, I would not use the word destroy, which is really a strong one. So, but yeah, I think a lot of industries and a lot of sectors have been adversely affected. And even before I go to sectors, I would say the most commonly affected are the poorest and marginalized individuals. Their jobs have been lost, their income sources have been reduced, and they have been, we know the migrant crisis, that people have to move from the wherever they had job to their homes back. So it is really challenging and tragic that impact of any natural calamity or even viruses and disease are most common on poorest and most marginalized. They are the worst affected. Second part is we also need to see from the perspective of children. Their education has been really adversely affected. We know that millions of children do not have access to such kind of mobile technology, and their education is worst affected, and we really hope that this would be resuming soon. So the human impact of the pandemic is really really something which has been really heavy toll, and we need to work immediately on addressing that. But coming to the industry and sectors also, we know that aviation sector was affected. Also hospitality, hotels, travel, so all these sectors are affected. But I would always give more importance to the human parts, that of course these sectors are affected, and then the people who are working those sectors lose their jobs. So this is a stark reminder for us, and it takes me to this earlier point which I made, that economy and health linkage, that we need to invest on improving health services. Governments need to invest on strengthening health services so pandemics can be prevented. For the benefit of audience, what entire world know two things. One, the world was always warned of the pandemics. We know that pandemics are realities of the time. This is not the first pandemic. This is not going to be the last pandemic. Pandemics will always be there. But to ensure that impact which this pandemic had on the people and industry is reduced or mitigated, then we need to governments need to invest on health system. Keep health systems and services ready so there is a surge capacity. So impact is mitigated. There is limited we can do to prevent pandemic, but we can be better prepared and better respond.
All right, sir. And I must say that because of this pandemic, now people are more conscious towards hygiene, health, and I think it should be continued, which previously we were not that much. And sir, my next question to you is...
Harsh, before you go to the next question, you raised a very valid and important point. So you said that people are more conscious about the health, hygiene, which is a good opportunity. And I want to highlight here one thing, that in the pandemic, I have been talking, people followed the face mask, hand washing, and physical distance. So who followed this? These people. And that's how the pandemic was reduced, the infection was reduced. But there is a very important learning from this. The non-communicable disease such as diabetes and hypertension. Now, India is considered a diabetic capital of the world because number of people are so high and hypertension is so widely prevalent. And these diabetes and hypertension future cause the severe disease which affect kidney, which affect brain and other part of heart and all this thing, and which require hospitalization and treatment, which is expensive cost. But what we know and which is scientifically proven, that to prevent these non-communicable diseases, there are four things which are required, which is healthy diet, regular physical activity, no smoking, and then moderate or no use of alcohol. Now, these are preventive intervention. The way people have followed face mask, hand washing, and physical distancing, if people can follow these four things, healthy diet, regular physical activity, no smoking, and no or moderate use of alcohol, then it can prevent them from diabetes and hypertension. So if people have followed one thing, I would really urge them to follow these approaches of four things, and they will be prevented from diabetes, hypertension. At least a large part of that will be reduced, and they can save the future costs on the treatment. This can prevent the mortality, which is harming or which is a lot of cost for the country. So that is the kind of learning we as a society, individual need to carry. If we can do in one area, I am so confident that we can do other area. All it requires little motivation, little repetition of the message.
Indeed, sir, it was really a great message. And I think the viewers, those who are watching this session, it will be fruitful for them. And not only I think, but I do strongly believe this. Sir, my next question to you is, what do you think, how long will it take for the normal citizen of India to get vaccinated?
So, Harsh, there are a few things which we know. One is that immediate prioritization for vaccination has been done for the frontline health workers and then essential services workers. So initially, those 30 million or 3 crore people will be vaccinated. And then second priority is the people who are more older than 50 years and those who are under 50 years but have some comorbidity such as diabetes, hypertension or something for which they are going on long-term treatment. So the second group of people are around 27 crore or 270 million. So that way 30 crore people will be vaccinated or are targeted for vaccination in India in 6 to 8 months. So what we can see that by third quarter or September 2021, around 30 crore population will be vaccinated. Now, of course, so the vaccination and who will be targeted is dependent upon the availability of vaccine. The supply of vaccine will be limited. Each vaccine requires 2 doses. So I don't see that much of the healthy adult population of less than 50 years will be vaccinated in this 2021, where a small proportion after September 2021 might start getting vaccination. And that might be targeted in some essential service, some people who are working class or who are at higher risk, but otherwise healthy. But at the same time, I want to flag that most of these vaccines have not been studied or the clinical trials have not been conducted in under 18 years of population. So let's forget about the vaccination for under 18 years. So under 18 year of population will not be vaccinated. The only population which is left is 18 to 50 years, which will have its turn sometime 2022 or even later. I'm saying even later because as of now, we don't know that how long the immunity after vaccination will last. So if immunity lasts 6 months or 9 months, then the people who are vaccinated in January might require another shot of vaccination if pandemic is still around. So they would require another shot in early 2022. And that way, the healthy adult population might not get vaccine that quickly. So that strategy will evolve. But I would say let's not worry about that. The immediate focus in high-risk population should be vaccinated, because ultimate purpose of this vaccination is prevent mortality and prevent the spread of the disease both. So if we have a fairly good number of population being vaccinated, especially those one who have a risk of severe disease, that's a good start. And it will also be dependent upon how much additional vaccines become available. The production capacity and number of additional vaccines which are licensed, it will depend upon how long the immunity lasts, as I described earlier. It will also depend upon whether the pandemic is still ongoing or pandemic is over. Once the pandemic is over, the approach to vaccination will be very different than what we are following. But I want to highlight one part, that even after the vaccination, okay, so two things are there. One is that a person is protected after, even the one who is receiving vaccine is protected after 14 days after second dose of vaccination. So if an individual receive vaccine on 16th of January, then another shot will be given a month later or 4 weeks later, let's say 13th or 14th February. And then another 2 weeks are required after the completed second dose to develop sufficient immunity. So the person can be protected after 28th of February or 1st March. So it does not, getting the vaccine does not mean you can go and then you are fully protected. You will be protected after some time. Second part is that all those who are vaccinated need to continue to follow those COVID appropriate behavior, three things, face mask, hand washing, and social distancing. Third and important part, and I guess audience will like this, though the vaccinated person likely to be protected, but we know that efficacy of vaccine can range from 60 to 90%. So that's why everybody had to wear masks, because we don't know who is protected. If 60% people means out of 10 people vaccinated, 6 will be protected, 4 will not be protected, and we will not know who are not protected. Second reason people need to follow COVID appropriate behavior, that these vaccines protect against the disease or the severe disease. But this vaccination does not mean person cannot get infection. Person can still get infection, but person will not develop serious disease, that's one. And if person can get infected, a vaccinated person may not fall sick, but can transfer the virus to other family members. So that's why it's important that we keep following COVID appropriate behavior. We keep being aware of all these things and keep passing on the good message. So summarize, health, we know the priority till September 2021, the 30 crore people will be vaccinated. Children are unlikely to be vaccinated. The 18 to 50 years, sometimes in 2022 or late 2021 might be targeting. But it's all good. We hope that this pandemic is over soon, and we will keep fighting till we win in our book.
We hope so, sir. Indeed, it was really a very important message from your side. And I think today it's the kind of privilege we got to hear all those things from you. Sir, I don't want to take you much time. So moving to my last question of this session, as we are still in mid of this pandemic, sir, what are your advices to the person, those who are watching this session?
So my advice is that please keep following COVID appropriate behavior. Please take care of your health. The good health is one of the assets for individual. In this pandemic, we have learned that if you are healthy and fit, you can fight many of the disease. Third part is that for adopting approaches which ensure a good mental health. Fourth message I would like to say, be good to others, share good messages, share knowledge which you have. But please don't share misinformation. Please don't scare people. Those are the things. And final part is that it will be incomplete fight if we don't learn from the pandemic. So, for example, while I was busy in the pandemic, it gave me some time to sit down and reflect that what I want to do. So we should utilize this opportunity, this challenge, as an opportunity to spend time with your family, with your loved one, learn some new skills, and also spread positivity. The pandemic will be over, so nobody should be scared.
All right, sir. It was really a very great message, and I was listening to you very carefully. You have given one very great message. It will be incomplete fight if we don't learn from this pandemic. And on this note, sir, I would like to wrap up today's session. It was a healthy discussion with you on the topic. Thank you so much, sir, for joining and giving your important time. We look forward to conduct more session with you in future.
Thank you very much, Harsh.
Thank you so much, sir.
On the ground is where I stand. Never give up, that was always the plan.
It's so cold outside.